I'm so honored to be here. Actually, on arriving at the airport in my Facebook, you know, informed me that I was same place and same time last year. So quite surreal. Actually, I spent the first week of October, almost every week spending in Taiwan. So happy to see all, and so not much actually the time. So I actually get into the reading my paper and then try to add on some sort of my opinion. We didn't actually contact a little bit. My topic is a little interesting that related to what she talked about. So a little bit another surprising thing. Okay, my presentation will discuss the origin of neoliberal biopolitics that could be traced back to Thomas Malthus. Malthus, an essay on the principle of population, anticipated the emergence of social Darwinism and marked the crisis of liberalism, which brought forth the problem of population against the political idea of the people. Malthus' idea of population was influential to moral philosophy. Even though his work aimed at reformulating liberal economics, his theory of population paved the way towards the neoliberal idea of human capital. Malthus is a liberal economist who was keen to the distribution of wealth, and as an adult liberal economist, he also worried about population explosion, in particular the eruption of the working class. This is a quite typical attitude you can see in any liberal economist in the 19th century, because they worry about such a lower working class on the sexuality. You know, they would actually reproduce many population, and that kind of actual number, this number of actual population will be threatened to the upper class. They actually keen to realize this kind of fact. That means that they create this sort of the hierarchical structure of a society, and they repeat. And as you know, that I think that kind of a typical realization still go on, in particular what I mean actually the Asian country. Malthus was the first economist to propose a systematic theory of population. He articulated his views regarding population, for which he collected empirical data to support his thesis. Malthus had a second edition of his book published in 1803, which he modified some of his views from the first edition, but essentially his original theory did not change. Actually, the second version is, as you know, actually the essay in the principle of population. The first version is totally forgotten, but the original idea wasn't changed. And another thing is that he used the kind of scientific methodology to actually support his thesis. That means that he might be a such a personal sociologist who actually try to use such a data, to the right on this kind of topic. The Malthus proposed the principle that human population grows exponentially while the food production grows at the arithmetic rate. This is actually his thesis. Thus, while food output was likely to increase in series of 25 years intervals in the arithmetic progression, for instance, 1, 2, 3, 4, this arithmetic progression, and so on, population was capable of increasing in geometric progression, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, blah, blah. So this scenario of arithmetic food growth with simultaneous geometric human population growth predicted the future when humans would have no resources for survival. So this is with the discourse of survival, like given birth. To avoid such a catastrophe, Malthus urged control on population growth. That means he got his own logic, agenda, why we should actually suppress growth of population. In this sense, actually population means not upper class population. Population means in necessary terms, that means the working class, or lower class, or in post-war system, definitely the population indicates third world, non-Western society. On the basis of a hypothetical world, population of 1 billion in the early 19th century and adequate means of subsistence at the time, Malthus suggested that there was a potential for population increase to 256 billion within 200 years. He actually said like this, but that the means of subsistence were only capable of being increased enough for 9 billion to be fed at the level of rebellion at the beginning of the period. Of course, this formula is rejected totally by a mathematician, but his topic, but quite interestingly, what I mean, his formulation of this kind of mathematical, you know, presupposition is rejected, but his topic, his thesis still quite powerful. And even actually, we actually witness these days a neo-Malthusian, you know, theorist who actually try to support neoliberal system. Okay, so, you know, he therefore considered that population increase should be kept down to the level at which it could be supported by operation various checks on the population growth, which he categorized as a preventive and a positive check. But preventive is a little bit preemptive, actually something, you know, but quite assertive, you know, policy. So that, for instance, actually, you know, actually making, you know, using some sort of, you know, the sex tool, you know, to actually prevent kind of a predicament, you know, something like this. It's a condom, it's invented by American Yomer system after the Second World War, or the, after the First World War, actually around 1930. So, the chief preventive check envisaged by Malthus was the moral restraint. Of course, you know, actually, the, alongside with, you know, this kind of technical, you know, tools, Malthus focused on, you know, we must put a implant this kind of moral restraint in working class. This is actually new moral philosophy. It's a kind of actually the idea of you know, public education. I mean, all right. So, which was seen as the deliberate decision by man to refrain from pursuing the dictate of nature in an early attachment to one woman. That is to say, marry later in life than had been usual, and only at the stage when fully capable of supporting a family. He actually practiced this, so he actually became married quite late in life, and he married, so of course, quite a young girl, a little bit. And he even actually insisted that actually the mature the man could be a good partner to the young girl. Actually, quite interesting that. This, it was anticipated, would give rise to smaller families and probably to fewer families, but Malthus was strongly opposed to birth control within marriage and did not suggest that parents should try to restrict the number of children born to them after their marriage. That means actually the thing is that actually the, he tried to put focus on marriage, and marriage could actually, you know, retain the kind of a growth of a population. Malthus was clearly aware that the problems might arise from the postponement of marriage to a late date, such as an increase in the number of illegitimate births, but considered that these problems were likely to be less serious than those caused by a continuation of rapid population increase. He saw positive checks to population growth as being any causes that contribute to the shortening of human lifespan, including in his category of poor living, working condition, that might give rise to low resistant disease, as well as more obvious factors such as disease itself, war and famine. Some of the conclusions that can be drawn from Malthus' ideas that does have obvious political connotation, and this partly accounts for their interest in his writings, and possibly also the misrepresentation of some of his ideas by authors such as Cobbett, the famous early English radical. Some later writers modify his ideas, suggesting, for example, strong government action to ensure later marriages. Others did not accept the view that the birth control should be forbidden after marriage. This idea actually reported to South Korea, and then, you know, the Park Chung-hee regime definitely tried to control the growth population. And even actually, you know, Rockefeller Foundation funded their one, and they sent an advisor, you know, to the Korean government, how to control this population. It's quite an enigmatic, you know, policy. Why did the American, you know, do that? Why try to actually suppress, you know, population in Seoul? This is quite an enigmatic one. And then this one is a little bit interesting, related to the, you know, the launching of the Olympic Games. You know, Olympic Games is the first day, you know, started from kind of, you know, to fear about, you know, the third world population and try to the encourage, you know, first world man to be strong. His theory of I mean, Malthus' theory of population seems to be opposite to what Marx pointed out in the Communist Manifesto. What the bourgeoisie therefore produces are its grave diggers. Malthus' attempt to prove the principle of population as a natural law of sexuality to criticize progress, racism, Marquis Conversin, and William Godwin advocate. William Godwin is Godwin is definitely and the very shortest father. And he also got, you know, later marriage. Malthus' theory bore on the presupposition that humankind has two fundamental needs, food and sex. Just like, you know, actually, food. These needs come along with the production of food and the reproduction of a population. What Malthus' concern about was that ability of reproduction is inherently greater than the capacity of production. From this perspective, Malthus maintained that growth of population should be under control. Otherwise, population level would double in size every 25 million years, as I said. Malthus' theory of population naturalized inequality in the human society because the imbalance between production and reproduction always caused limited distribution of wealth. This is actually the strong difference between Marxist economist and the liberal economist. Liberal economist always put forward, you know, this position, the property is limited. You know, that means capacity to produce the property is limited because human being is limited, you know, the being. That's why we must, you know, suppress the population. Otherwise, all have to die, something like that. This is actually the, I think, deeper, you know, ideology which actually supports the neoliberalism. I wanna go to the actually get on the, you know, last bus. Afterwards I got lost. Something like that. This is actually the competition logic. And this one is quite, you know, quite dominant today. My argument is that Malthus' ideal population was a turning point in which the crisis of liberalism, for instance, utilitarianism found itself on the way towards social revolutionism. And further by politics. So many of his contemporary critics attacked Malthus and proved his theoretical policy, but his thesis still survived. The Malthusian naturalization population seemed to succeed in canceling the political idea of a people. Those who, the people, have made a contract with the state and bringing forward the ideal population. Those who should be controlled and managed by themselves as well as the state. What is the meaning of the transition from people to population? This is my point actually. Versus the, you know, presuppose, you know, the people no longer, you know, actually a political subject. You know, or some, we need actually kind of a scientific, you know, understanding of population rather than the people. The Malthusian presupposition seems to be opposed to Thomas Hobbes' conceptualization of people. In the Hobbesian terms, people are those who get redemption from multitude through a social contract. According to Hobbes, multitude as mob is the state of nature which is in danger of war. He distrusted the mob and thought people as stable status of individuals. The Hobbesian individual is an egoist who does not allow an elite orator to dominate his or her mind. Hobbes worried about passionate propaganda to stimulate the madness of the mob. What is stressed here is not Hobbes' fear of the crowd, because actually the liberalists have a kind of fear about working class in the crowd, but rather his alert, the elite's rash act, I mean, elite's, you know, propaganda would actually cause so dangerous situation. He also actually criticized elites as well. You know? In this sense, the Hobbesian concept of people contains utopian dimension. For Hobbes, people is always someone to come, or people to come, something. This idea reminds us of the Machiavellian prince. However, Pope's prince, a sovereign, is not such a ruler who should appeal to his subject for love. His Machiavellian prince always appealed to his, actually the, you know, the people for love. The actual Machiavellian prince must be loved by the people, otherwise he loses his actual authority. But the Hobbesian sovereign is not like that. It's not actually the personal character. It's definitely kind of, you know, the authority which was given by a systemic mechanism. The sovereign in the Hobbes term is the ruler to whom everyone gives up his or her right for their security. Therefore, people would enjoy more liberty under the regime of monarchy rather than democracy. Dictatorship is better than sustainable democracy. This is a Hobbesian idea. Because the mighty king will be more modest in behavior than the leader of the mob. This is the way in which we can find a similarity between Confucianism and actually, you know, Hobbesian liberalism. People is the collective group of the individuals, and each makes the covenant with the sovereign. It means that this is quite interesting, you know, it reminds us of kind of a Lacanian, you know, the concept of fantasy, or a second interpretation of Lacan's fantasy. That means people want this kind of sovereign. People want that. The hopes actually, the, you know, the, understood how actually this kind of sovereignty is possible. What is at stake in Hobbes' argument is not that sovereign has absolute power, but that everyone is equal under the impunity of the ruler. People wanna, you know, create him. It's not necessarily a typical country. They actually call themselves, you know, the People's Democratic Republic. But definitely, what they actually created is such a detail. The relation between sovereign and people is exactly a political model of modernity. It is, of course, that artificial formulation of ideology would be adequate to explaining how the relation works so as to reproduce the object. Hobbes implied that it is the people who would like to collaborate with absolute sovereign. In this way, people become to the equal subject. So actually, Hobbes presupposed, you know, subject is equal, you know, and this equal subject, you know, create or some require sovereign to actually securing their, you know, the happiness. Hobbes pointed out that liberty is the compensation of the regulating excessive action. It is interesting that he identified freedom with the trade and control. This actually reminds us of David Hume. David Hume also argued that trade would encourage the peaceful relation among nations. The quote, the increase of riches and commerce in any nation instead of hurting commonly promotes the riches and commerce of all its neighborhoods, end quote. Hobbes' idea of liberty is a shared viewpoint with other moral philosophers. In this sense, the idea of people or the imagination of the collective individual is the core of liberalism and easily yields to the one of the population. Even though Hobbes regarded the people as the ultimate entity of politics, the unity of individuals presupposes economic principle. People is the byproduct of economic growth and the commonwealth. It is not agent politics, but the consequence of rational communication exchange. For instance, actually the trade and contract, these actually made, you know, people. From this perspective, Hobbes argued that politics should depend on science, the knowledge of a consequence of words rather than emotion or passion. However, people in Hobbesian terms contains the passion towards the multitude. If a politics fails, the monstrous power of multitude will erupt. When Malthus suggested the principle of population as a potential evil to destroy humanity, he would intend to go further beyond Hobbes' doctrine of people. Malthus was more pessimistic than Hobbes. He adopted the Hobbesian idea of life. Life is a consistent struggle, one against all. This idea appealed to Malthus, and he developed the doctrine of population. Of course, he actually endowed, you know, this concept to Darwin. Darwin was his colleague. Before NASA, the population was a term to indicate an asset. NASA changed its meaning to the uncalculable abyss of a sexual desire. He removed the possible rationality from people and preserved the economic sense of the principle of population in the Malthusian doctrine was the natural law of evolution and nothing to do with human choice.
Okay, Gregor Mendel's genetic inspired Malthus' conceptualization of population. Alright, so adopting a different genetic theory, he actually developed his theory. That's why I said he was using data, scientific data, to support his sociological work. I think this is actually a new model in those days. Okay, just skip up to the boat.
Okay, so the principle of the population in Malthus' sense is the horrific abyss of the mob. The mob does not revolt to the sovereign, but reproduce their lives infinitely. This is actually a different aspect we can see in the Malthus from what Hobbes said. In Hobbesian presupposition, if you don't do actually sovereign fail to the rule over the people, people will revolt. Against the sovereign. It might actually be a cause kind of revolution or change actually the regime. But Malthus said nothing. Just a chaotic, chaotic situation will come. So if you wanna keep on the road, you must actually suppress. You must actually rule over the people properly. It's not people, just the population. Their living energy is so strong that no sovereign is able to control them. This is actually the basic idea Malthus proposed. The people is so strong, no any sovereign, no any government can control this one. So the individual hopes to presuppose as the minimum entity in modern society is endangered by the natural law of the population in Malthus' sense. Malthus' imagination of population anticipates contemporary biopolitics since 1960, the meaning of biopolitics assumed a turning point. It emphasized life as the new object of politics. That means actually environmental biopolitics came up. This is definitely actually regard life as kind of object of politics. But I don't little bit agree with this kind of idea. That means environmental biopolitics, because biopolitics is actually quite open, term. We need actually to settle down, but I would like to focus on the Foucault rather than other biopolitics theory. So since the 1970s, the significance of biopolitics was augmenting and opened a new era of bioethics. This is what exactly we actually witness these days. We must encourage life, and I think this kind of subsequent of Lenin's philosophy of life. Something life is kind of a healing energy to the environment, healing energy to the so-called the environmental problems. I jump to the Michel Foucault. So this is my conclusion. No one observed this situation more clearly than Michel Foucault. He understood the shift in the field of politics and scrutinized the meaning of biopolitics. Biopolitics is, in Foucaultian sense, not the biological determinism, but the historical processing of life as such comes to the center of politics. This is a little bit slightly different. He conceptualized the biopolitics as a specific point to exercise political power. What is important in his discussion of biopolitics is that he criticized both theories of biopolitics, life as the political foundation and life as the object of politics. He criticized both. He rather suggested that the biopolitics does not extend traditional politics. That means it's not a substitution or a supplement to liberalism. It's definitely this biopolitics actually marked a break, with the kind of liberalism. This is actually the Foucault's quite interesting argument about biopolitics. I think this is the reason why I focused on this Foucault's presupposition about the biopolitics is that he historicized biopolitics. He historicized biopolitics and he tried to explain that this kind of the benefit of biopolitics in relation to the end of liberalism or the crisis of liberalism. This is, I think, a very important political intervention in you know, actually they are the biopolitic discourse.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Many thanks.